Right. The afternoon is good. So good afternoon. This is Radiation, the number one station for the Asian invasion. It's a real pleasure and an honour to have the company, talent and wisdom of guitarist, composer, Aziz Ibrahim. So in the proverbial words of Tracy the Tart, shut up and show us your willy. Take it away, Aziz.
You can't be talking to me. And just for that, I'm going to give you a bit of Jesse J. Enough of messing around. I don't know what it is about that tune. I really like it.
I think you bring the magic to it, to be honest. And it's just an honour to have you on the show, Aziz. It's a real pleasure. And we're live on Radiation and the One Station.
Look what you've done already, eh? Oh. That's from your show.
Oh, the fault. Oh, sorry about the injury. I'm so sorry.
So he's not getting very in focus, is it? There you go.
Oh, my God, yeah. Oh, wow. I apologize. Wow. I guess on the occult plane, you've drawn blood. So they have it. It's just, I'm not going to ask you to play anymore, man, after that. But thank you so much. And there's an old story with Robert Harrison. He's a cool guitarist. I used to work with an old friend. And he cut his fingers when we was... tracking one of the songs as well. Great vibes. It's our first message coming in. Thank you so much, Lord Mantio. And right before the show kicked off, what I did, I was listening to some of your music. I thought I went back in time and to Rush Home Rock, and I thought that looks interesting. I fought the law and the law won, right? And I picked up on that. I thought, wow, I thought it's like a psychedelic sort of masterpiece. So can you talk about that for a second?
Well, yeah, it was one of those, you know, when you foolishly decide to do a cover, you say, we need a cover. I mean, I was a solo artist, but I was working with a fabulous tabla player called Dalbir Singratan, lives in Birmingham, and we were a band for like 20, well, we still are, we're a band, kind of like a White Stripes from Mumbai kind of band, and... we were looking for a tune which was like a calling card, something that people would recognize, because a lot of the stuff can get quite crazy and deep, almost. As Paul Weller says, we sounded like Paul Train on his last album, Interstellar. I don't know what the connection is, but that's what he said. And so we went through genres, and I was just thinking of a certain song which I thought... that song, everybody knows, almost everybody knows. And I thought, wouldn't it be great to do a tabla guitar version, you know, two South Asian lads, you know, a Sikh and a Muslim guy playing I Fought the Law and the Law Won. So it just seemed appropriate, really. And I like the Clash's version, even though it was written by Sonny Curtis of the Crickets in 1957, I think, I believe. So it's not actually... I mean, loads of bands have covered it.
To be fair, I think you've done it justice. And I think, if I'm correct... which one was a 9 minute piece? Was that the one I was listening to?
Well, there's a 9 and there's a 13 minute piece. Probably there's two really long. There's one about 15 minutes long.
It doesn't feel it though.
Marassi is probably about that, and the other is Zen and Now. Two instrumentals, very long. They're from two BBC Maid of Vale sessions that we did in Studio 4, famous for Jimmy, not Jimmy Patel from Blackpool, but Jimmy. Hendrix and
Jimmy Patel.
Yeah, it's a common mistake. Yeah, it's a common mistake. Jimmy Patel from Blackpool. But yeah, I meant Hendrix from America. And
the word Marassi. We can quickly go into this. So why was it titled Marassi? Because people will say, you know, that's like you educate the listeners on the word Marassi.
Well, the Marassi, it was to most people, you know, my age or people who take up music or anything in the arts, it's a derogatory term used on towards their, you know, offspring to say that, you know, get a proper job, basically, look what you've turned into. It's a derogatory term, but it's actually... I don't know if it's a sect or whether you would call it. I mean, Marassis are actually genealogists, believe it or not.
Really?
They exist in predominantly northern India, but they're genealogists, also entertainers. So they do music, dance, poetry, reading, and singing. So they cover the arts, and they worked in the Mughal courts a lot originally, so they had quite a high reputation. So in actual fact, it's the opposite to the way the term has been overtaken. But they knew the family tree. They generally tended to stick to their own, you know, family and married into the family, so to speak. But there are Babis, there are Marassis, and... You know, they exist in various states over northern India and further, but they have such a cool history and musical history. But like I said, it was one of those terms my dad used to tell me. So I just thought, what a great idea, you know, a title for a tune that something, you know, when you got a generation gap and you've been called something, and I wanted to play music, and music, you know, people say is, you know, well, in certain cultures, in my culture, they say it's haram or something, and it's from the devil and all this kind of thing, and which I don't believe at all. I just thought it was a great title, and I thought I'd write a piece of music that my dad might go, oh, I really like that piece of music, and I'd tell him, Dad, it's called Marassi.
What was his reaction to that?
He just laughed. He just laughed his socks. He had a sense of humour. He understood. Yeah.
Absolutely brilliant, because I think what they say is what I was told is that when a Marassi baby cries, even the baby cries in tune.
Well, you know, I mean, it's funnily enough, I mean, I'm working at Manchester Museum as part of the co-curation team for the music, dance and sound anthology. And you know, I'm thinking about sounds and think about that all the time, about what sound is and what music is and how that came about, and looking at objects like, you know, the conch shell from the Indus Valley civilization is like one of the first predominant sounds that led into music and things, and just vibrations in general, about the science of vibration and what that actually is, and how sound can be, as you know, we had that conversation, you were telling about, you know, sounds used as weapons and so forth, which they do exist, obviously, you know, they've been tested. But for me, you know, sound is something I employ in music to bring about communication and positivity, and something that doesn't require passports. You know, I don't need a passport to transmit audio, you know, sound waves. and communicate with people. I've worked a lot in hospices, like Keach Hospice, and not a lot, but I've worked in like Keach Hospice with you know, terminally ill children, and I use sound and vibrations as a communication tool. They wouldn't speak per se, or we didn't know each other, but music was a way of communicating. And I work in prisons as well, like HMP Risley, and it was the same. And, you know, music, that tool of communication, conversation point, just generally, you know, relaxed. And you know, somebody would say, hey, play Waterfall or something like that. So I'd play that as a starting point. Whoops, he's messed up already.
Nah, it's all
right. It's gone into the wrong change. Where's that other bit gone? Somebody will say... Anyway, it's great. I can just correct myself like that.
Well, I think the good thing is to hopefully let the finger heal being the key thing. Now regarding you heard the one about the Tibetan monks using these huge horns, and the sound will make the rocks jump. So it sounds a bit mad, but
no. But, you know, I wouldn't doubt that for one second.
Exactly.
As soon as you say Tibetan monks, you know, that's it's all game over.
Exactly. It is. And there was the one that that shapes...
It's not quite the same if you said, like, you know, the Gorton monks or something like that. You know, Gorton monks of Manchester. I'd be like, I'd have to phone the chief monk over there. He's a friend of mine.
Oh, wow. But what I was getting at is various shapes apparently... can emit sound frequency. So in Jill Matson's book, The Lost Waves of Time, I think she says something about when someone's got a crack in their skull, they'd put a ostrich egg near the skull, and as a result, the skull would heal faster. Who knows? Look where I've just...
You're greeted by silence there. Yeah.
Right, so tell us about...
Something you need to experience, isn't it? It's something you need to experience.
It is. It is. Yeah. Tell us about being a musician in residence, the sound of heritage. Please educate me.
Yeah, it's very hard to start a conversation of something that is normally referred to as artist in residence. You know, people hear that term a lot from art galleries and museums and libraries. And, you know, we have an artist in residence and that is so-and-so. And I've been thinking about this idea of musicians being the artists, which they are. And I was fortunate to run into the head of Heritage and Learning, Dave Brookhouse from Heritage and Learning Lancashire, which is part of LCC, Lancashire County Council. So I was talking to him about it one day, saying that, you know, musicians should play a part. Why doesn't music play a big part in cultural spaces and heritage sites? You know, it's that kind of thing. You know, who doesn't like music? I mean, there are people, believe it, who don't like music. Okay, but let's not talk about them for a second. Let's talk about the ones who do. In general, if you use music as something to invite people, I mean, it's like setting a mood, isn't it? You set a mood with a music. But to actually engage people through music in places which belong to the community, in a sense, you know, they're there for... They're inviting to people. They want people to come in. They want people to share in the heritage and the history. But because I'm a music guy, I always thought about, well, why isn't there any music in there? I'm not interested. I was never interested in museums when I was young. You know, I hated them. I just been getting dragged to them. But if music was there, it would be a different story. I'd be in like a shot. So I just thought, wouldn't that be a cool thing to have music as the primary component within a heritage site, like a castle or something? It's like one of the places I'm actually working at the moment is, or will be, is Clitheroe Castle in Clitheroe. But I just generally thought about music as being, you know, the musician in residence. Also as an encouragement to younger musicians or other musicians, not necessarily just young, to approach cultural spaces and say, listen, I'd like to do something here. I've got an idea as such, instead of looking at it as like that place is elitist and it's not for me kind of thing. So that's how it began. So this idea of musician in residence, and Dave went for it, and I thought generally as it was kind of introduced to the team and so forth that it made sense to people, and it led to a project called The Sound of Heritage, and that was just about what does heritage sound like, you know?
Yes.
What does heritage sound like? That was the question I was asking, and from that I've built a whole project, which I'm going to be working at the. At the moment, initially, it's going to be from Clitheroe Castle, Helmshaw Textile Mills Museum, and which is two mills, and also Gawthorpe Hall, which is a beautiful place, stately home, kind of gardens and whatnot. And I just thought, you know, to have a Pakistani Muslim working class, you know, council estate boy come in and start going, can I play some music here? Can I touch this? Can I play with that? Can I... But it's a music response. You know, it's like if you put a musician somewhere, he's going to think of things in terms of audio. What does heritage sound like? So as I'm walking through these places and documenting, I'm thinking about music and can we have a club night here? Can we have a... I mean, I know that's going to cause shockwaves and horror amongst the vibrations will destroy the... whatever. But that is what I'm thinking. I'm thinking about where can we have the gig? Where can we do a live stream? Where can we, how can I respond to these things? Where's the musical history? Not just that, also the cultural histories. You know, Britain has such a relationship, good or bad, with the world, you know, from South Asia, Africa, China, the whole world, you know, slavery, all these factors. And they kind of... they're hidden within these things. You know, textiles, as soon as you start talking textiles, if you're not talking about the Indian kind of textile industry and that relationship and the East India Company and the Crown taking over in the 19th century and so forth, then, you know, there's a big hole in your knowledge or a big hole in history. Yeah. And that was the kind of history I was taught at school. You know, it was full of, it was... and it was full of holes. And it wasn't until I was older that I started to see these holes or to understand. Let me give you an example. I was on tour. I worked a lot with the British Council.
Yeah.
And I toured in the Middle East a lot. And I actually ended up in Libya and Syria. And in Syria, I was in Damascus. And in Damascus, I was at a mosque called the Tower of Light Mosque. I believe it. That's what it's referred to in Arabic. And there was the tomb of John the Baptist within the mosque. And it was just mind-blowing to me. It was something I was never told.
Whoa. Are we talking about John the Baptist? Is it Salome's dance where he was beheaded? And apparently, isn't the actual skull meant to be at Rosalind Chapel in Scotland?
I heard that. Yeah, I heard that. But the actual shrine and the tomb of it is in this mosque in Damascus.
Wow.
And all these pilgrims turn up there regularly, as you know, regular as clockwork. And it's a beautiful place. But it's just that revelation of seeing things from the other side. It opens your eyes and ears, and you come home and thinking of these things. And being in India and looking at, you know, when I was there on tour. In Bengal and Kolkata and so forth, and seeing that a place that looked like London, literally, the statues, the buildings, because it was the capital in a sense, I believe, and that's the first place the East India Company landed. But in a sense, coming back to, say, like the mills over here and so forth, the only thing I ever heard of was about Gandhi's visit, and there are photographs up there, you know, especially in Lancashire, as he, you know, he related to other people of Lancashire related to him. But there's so much history like that, connections, and we have huge South Asian communities and other cultures within Lancashire and all the every single, you know, county in the country. And I just thought music would be a good medium through which to communicate a lot of this history and the sounds of and just general, in general, as a musician, you know, how would I respond, really? What would I think of? What would I want to do? And hopefully it's something that would interest other people who like music or, you know, like the arts, you know, dance and music and poetry and whatever it is. You know, I'm just trying to create some kind of leveling field where, like me, you don't feel that it's just for somebody else and it's for the elite or something. It's for everybody to enjoy and that we can engage in different ways and kind of break the institution of to, you know, think of new ways of approaching. I haven't got all the answers, to tell you the truth, Dab. It's just, it's a pilot, initial stages, you know, and that's how I believe it happens.
Excellent. Well, what it is, you mentioned the word working class, so could you tell us a bit about your work with the University of Salford and the Doctor of Arts, because you're a doctor?
You know, I laugh every single time somebody's Doctor of Arts. And yes, thank you, University of Salford, who gave me an honorary degree, honorary PhD, along with Peter Hooker. We graduated at the same time, but I think he's graduated a few more times than I have from different unis. It's funny because I'm a musician. I've ended up a musician, you know, through Simply Red, the Stone Roses, Asia, the only Asian in Asia, and yeah, Stephen Wilson, quite a few outfits. There's loads, you know, Hot Chocolate. If I'd started reeling off, I forget what that CV is.
It's quite big.
What? I've been lucky, I've been fortunate and blessed in that way, but my dad originally wanted me to be a doctor. He wanted me to be a doctor of medicine. And it wasn't until 1987 when Simply Red rang me up and offered me the job as guitarist in Simply Red that I thought about an alternate destiny, or fate. And but I've seemed to have come full circle what he originally wanted. I've ended up
as a doctor. It's all right.
And the funniest thing is the wedding proposals have started to come in.
No. Really?
Yeah. The wedding proposals have started to come in, and you know, people half my age, and it just makes me angry, and at the same time it makes me laugh, you know, because I mean in the early days of nobody wanted to know because they called you this term morassi,
so, yeah.
You know, he's a deadbeat layabout, he hasn't got a proper job, you can't think about a marriage with him, you know. But anyway, on a lighter note, yeah.
Wow. So yeah. Simply Red, the Stone Roses, Ian Brown, Paul Weller, Stephen Wilson, Asia, Rebel MC, Errol Brown, Hot Chocolate.
Yeah. I was a hip hop guy, eh? I was a hip hop guy too. Never mind all that kind of, yeah. You know.
Aziz, what's interesting is your work with Overload, right? Overload.
That was a bit over the top.
Over the top.
Brummy then. Over the top Brummy.
Overload. Loud. Bath.
Yeah.
The Pakistani band, man. So that, I need to check those out. And tell me about Threat Sector and how the hell did EDM come about with guitar work? That must be amazing.
I mean, really, it's just I don't know if I can. Let me just flip over to another camera. Won't be a second.
Cool, man.
I had this. Here's one I made earlier. So I set up my old iPhone 6 S to act as another camera for this transmission. So I can just flip to the phone. Is that right?
Technological wizard.
There you go. So at the moment, one of my main uses during my Arts Council projects was the iPad, because I wanted to work in a digital manner. And I didn't want to use laptops because I wanted to say that, well, I mean, you know, the cost of a laptop is huge. Compared to buying some kind of mobile devices. So my project was working with mobile devices. And again, back to this project, Musician in Residence, you know, Sound of Heritage, is about using mobile devices as musical tools. I'm using them as cameras, for instance. Digitally, I'm using them as a social media point. Musically, I just want to show you a couple of apps. So
yes, certainly. You're very up there when it comes to the technological side of stuff.
Give over, lad. So this is an app called Figure, for instance. It's going to be sideways because I've got my iPad sideways. Okay. You can hear that. Here we go. I have two things playing at the same time then.
It's all right. So what is this musical box?
So there are three. This is a thing called Figure by Reason, and it's playing three parts. It's playing drums, bass, and a keyboard part, which you can write with your fingers. You don't need to play a keyboard, and the app is free. That's what I love about it. So you can share it with, you know, anybody who's got a phone or something like that.
Are you talking about like the same company that makes propeller heads, Reason?
That's right, the same company.
Wow. Wow.
But I mean, simple apps like, let me think, something like this. This is a sample toy. You can get it on your phone quite easily.
Yes.
I just want to see if this will work. Just one second.
Okay.
You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation.
Wow.
You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation. You are.
Let me turn this up.
That is amazing.
You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation.
You are watching Radiation. You are watching
Radiation. You are watching Radiation.
I love it.
You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation. You are watching Radiation. You are
watching Radiation. I just like digital tools. I've got about 200 apps on the iPad alone and on my phone. Most things I'm using at the moment are digital. Even my amps, for instance, you know, I'm using digital amps like these Kemper profilers.
Yes.
And I'm also at the same time using the Line 6 HX Stomp, which is, again, you know, that. Whereas this is profiling, the German amps here, these digital amps. This digital amp, which is American, the Line 6 HX Stomp, is modeling. So there's a chain of effects and amplifiers and speakers within that chain. And I can just plug pedals like these, standard guitar pedals. Well, they're not standard, they're quite boutique, but pedals like this into a virtual amplifier, which will run into my mixer. And then that's connected USB to my laptop. And hello, there you are. And obviously you're getting me from my camera feed.
I said it to you yesterday. You are a presenter's dream because the way you're so
really?
Organized with it, amazing audio, amazing video, the way you're using cameras and technology. Now I've got to ask you a question. I've got a picture of you with a whole bunch of Marshall.
Before you launch into that, my friend, let me tell you something. That the reason for this has come about from this pandemic. From last year, from March, I haven't worked. You know, like most musicians, we've lost over 90% of our income. And I mean, it was fortunate for me that I was working in the arts and culture sector. I'd made contact with people, but the problem was that I couldn't deliver any work to them because of the limitations of being able to go to the places, or concerts being a problem, or any crowds or so forth. So in March, what I did, and it had nothing to do with what the government said, I just thought that I need a new skill set. I need a new skill set. And the skill set that I have and the tools that I have don't cut it. So I look for digital tools. That was the first thing. And I couldn't afford them. So what I did was to sell a few of these and to sell a few of, you know, my equipment that I had, the analog things, to purchase some of the digital things that I needed, like a camera. And I looked for free software. So basically all I did was I retrained in a sense. I watched endless YouTube videos for all last year. I mean, I don't really watch any other channels apart from YouTube. And I was learning from young people. I was learning from gamers. I was learning from podcasters like yourself. I was learning from content creators, basically. So in doing so, I learned a whole new skill set about live streaming and about content creation. And I'm not saying that I'm there, but I'm just saying, and with the help of certain companies like, you know, this microphone I'm using, that, you know, I worked on how to create content because I thought that's the way I'm going to have to work in the future. And some of this, you know, I can go and do gigs and share you a bit of, you know, guitar, but sit here and actually give you close-ups and things and really get down to the nitty-gritty and show you, you know, hey, here's a hologram microcosm and it does this. It's like I can share those things quite easily, and I think it's more about confidence. Once you start, you have the tools, and you relax with them, then you can start sharing things a lot better. And I got involved. Sorry. Anyway, I retrained myself.
Yeah. But listen, people are here to listen to you, not to me. They hear my voice and corny jokes all day long.
Well, I've not heard them yet, so.
But okay, so basically you embraced new tech and like cutting edge stuff as well to basically
And the platforms too, you know. Yeah. My digital releases now are through the kind of digital channels. Yes, Spotify, yes, Amazon, yes, Apple, Bandcamp, you name it, I'm probably on that platform. Because you just have to, sometimes you have to adapt. Yeah, you can object and you can, you know, debate, but we have to do something. And I think it might be part of a South Asian gene of adapting, surviving. And as a musician, to survive, you know, I got certain advantages and legacy. So I don't take that for granted, but for people who don't have, that is so difficult and has been so difficult, not to mention the mental health and well-being and the pressures on people and social pressures and families, you know, falling apart, so forth. You know, to even start and go there, you know, you can understand why I want to do music, why I want to be active, still playing music and communicating with people and hopefully lifting spirits through, you know, the work I do.
Most definitely, man. I was going to say to you was you spoke about new releases. Could you tell us a bit about the upcoming flamenco?
Yeah. So I'm part of a collective called the Guitar Collective, and they are a South Asian guitarist collective and their diaspora around the world. So me being one of them from the UK. It's a fantastic group. I mean, like I said about no passports required, you know, our members are India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, US, Canada, States, Australia, the ones I can think of right now, you know, and Dubai and so forth. It's fantastic. You know, you're communicating with each other and sharing music, and we're supporting each other in the releases as well. Somebody has a new release and we all share, and we all have, you know, live shows like this about that release. So helping each other, basically. It's like a brother-sisterhood. you know. So that, I can't remember what the question was, but
about flamenco, yeah.
Yeah, so we had this one subject where we were going an introductory compilation video. Everybody was to do 25 seconds of audio for at 115 BPM in the key of D minor, the saddest key of all, according to Spinal Tap. But according to Nigel, the saddest key of all. So I submitted my 25 seconds. Initially, I was kind of like, no, I haven't got time and all that. But I love that deadline. So I did it because it was pushing me and I had to use these tools to create it. And I mean, just bear with me one sec. I'm just going to slip into something more comfortable. So this, I was thinking about what piece to play.
Cool. We've got a message coming in that says,
I have to take these headphones off.
That is, it's cool. Oh yeah. Brilliant. 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 I think we're going to have so many guitar. Whoa. That was going to be expensive.
Nearly.
Well, we've got messaging. Love the guitars. What a cool studio. Great vibe. Such an interesting guy. It's great that you're merging music, arts, culture, and history. Lord Mantio. Thank you, my lord.
You know I can't hear you, don't you? When I've got my headphones off.
Oh, sorry, sorry. Yeah, yeah. Again, interesting guy. It's great that he's merging music, arts, culture, and history from Lord Mantio, from probably in his manor in, I don't know, somewhere, but that's Lord Mantio. Love the guitars, cool studio. That would have been expensive. So tell me about this guitar you got here.
Yeah, I mean, this is a nylon string, a Godin, Godin Multiac, in fact. It has synthesizer controls here for a MIDI output. And the GK, Roland GK kind of standard. And then that's the standard piezo, which sits under the saddles. So you get the standard acoustic sound. Great thing about these things, you can have presets.
Yes, yes. Digital technology.
There we go. So it was going through a guitar preamp. You know, I was simulating an electric guitar amplifier, so it wasn't sounding right. My ears were telling me that's not right. So this is what it would normally sound like. I mean, all the tones of that kind of. You know, you're getting the nylon tones. So I wanted to do something because I had a feeling most people were going to mosh out, with the exception of a few guys who were going to dare to do something different. So I wanted to approach it a little bit different, and I had this little progression of chords. So I just wrote this progression for 25 seconds and then played a little bit of a solo on top. I mean, I'm not an acoustic player, really. I've been playing acoustic for a long, long time, but, you know, my approach is obviously as an electric guitarist. But anyway, this piece came about from this guitar that inspired a piece, 25 seconds of music. And I was thinking about a song title and a flamenco. And I thought, Mank, I'm a Mank, yeah, flamenco. <yeah. laughs> So it's one of them cheeky, all right, mate, moments of it. Down, 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 down.
Hey, monk, I'm a monk. Yeah, top one, mate.
The next minute it was called Flamenco. And there you go, that piece came about. It was at the right tempo and so forth like that. I just had to jostle it around a little bit with the chords. But it's the guitar that was inspirational. So the tones and the sounds of these guitars, that's why. And if I added a touch of reverb, maybe? You get that really nice... Nylon strings are a beautiful tone. They're also good for kids because they're not so hard on the fingers. So I normally recommend to kids, to get a guitarlele or something like that, instead of a ukulele to learn guitar on.
Talking about you mentioned that, and that triggered something in my head. I was reading your profile earlier, and you basically been training the youth in music as well, haven't you?
Training the youth, yeah, lining them up. Get trained. I don't know if I'd put it like that. I've been training the youth. I think it's because I know I'm young at heart at the end of the day, and I have an empathy towards what younger people maybe would like. Maybe I don't know what they like, but I do know as a child, a lot of things weren't available to me, and the way I was taught music at school, I hated music at school. So it's not about music, it's about the way that it's taught. It's about the institution, and that's part of this project that I'm doing as a musician in residence, is about breaking down the institution in a way and new approaches, and so that young kids don't go through what I went through as a child and hating something in that way. But it's because of the approach. A new and a fresher approach and dealing with genres of music which someone can relate to. It's like the national curriculum, If you're going to still, yes, we've got a change in the national curriculum and it's going to have, multicultural content. But if that multicultural content is still as elite and classist, as it originally was when it was like a white history, then there's no difference. You're still not going to relate to it. No one's going to, unless you stick a bit of grime in there and a bit of trap and a bit of a drill, get some drillers in there and, that will make a difference, get some rap in there in various forms. And I'm not talking always like Blackpool rap. There are very many forms of it. But hence this project again, because it all points at that thing where I do feel the plight for younger people that, access to places and being able to use a facility and feel like their own, that they have access, instead of being feeling like, oi, get off, get off the land or whatever kind of thing it is. What are you doing here? Kind of. I don't want that. I want them to feel invited. I want them to feel a part of it. And also that culture isn't just like pure cultures. Cultures are mixed. People come from dual heritage, they're adopted, no parents, whatever. But they know there's something in their history which involves loads of cultures. So I don't want these places for people to feel that, a castle or a mill or a gallery or whatever is like a pure culture. I want them to feel that it's a mix of cultures and that it has a history of a mix of cultures, and you have a right to be there, and you have a right to also say what should be in there as well. And and that's my involvement with kids, I think, or younger people, that I want to stay in touch in a sense, and I want to learn as well, that it's not about me. And it becomes a bit narcissistic when I'm always rabbiting on about what I like and what I want to do, but to think about what other people want to do and what they like and why they hate and why they love and so forth, that it gives you a better understanding and giving control as well, handing that control over, stop being a control freak.
True, but I noticed regarding that, because you're not a selfish person clearly, because if Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth recognizes your contributions to the economy, culture, music industry at Buckingham Palace. And how was that for you?
Well, I just wanted to see the toilets that John and Ringo, John and Paul had a big, it wasn't that big, but they had a bifter somewhere, one of the royal toilets. I wanted to say, I was here, lads, shoot a little video, but we weren't allowed to take any phones in, so that was that. It was quite something. I mean, it was at the, basically, it was at the tail end of all my British Council work. So I'd done this tour of Libya, you know, played in Tripoli and Benghazi and so forth, and then I'd done lectures at universities for, you know, students, and then performances and talking to young people, and then Libya and Syria and Tunisia, Morocco and Jerusalem, which was one of the hardest shows I ever did, one of the most beautiful shows I ever did, and then India and Pakistan and Bangladesh. And after all this work, I got invited to Buckingham Palace, along with Eric Clapton, Brian May, Jimmy Page, the Bee Gees, and Sir Jim Marshall, the Marshall Amplifiers. Who else was there?
Really?
Andrew Lloyd Webber and his bird.
Whatever his name is.
And a right combination. Sorry, I know that's a bit uncouth.
Doesn't matter. It's
can't
funny.
Remember. I can't. Yeah, so hey, you can see I'm resorting back to the Mang now. I can't remember. No. And that was a hell of people, a lot of people there. I'm in this row, you know. I felt that kind of people are looking like, who are you? But I love that. I love that. I felt like saying, yeah, I'm this Pakistani Muslim working class kid from Longsight Council Estate, the Anson Estate, here with you lot in the same row. And I've got a right to be here. Okay.
Oh, wow. Well, but it's a massive... It's just one of your massive achievements. You're a very humble guy. So I've noticed that, like... hold on. One thing I've got to get out of the way, and it's important. Salute to Silver Finger Singh from BBC Radio Leeds for the hookup.
Cause if it absolutely, was, yeah. Yeah, to Raj, yeah, enough respect. And to his dad, who people know as Goldfinger, Inder Goldfinger from the Ian Brown Band, and a fantastic double player and percussionist who's been on the Hacienda Classical Tour and should be still on it right now. Why isn't he still on it? Why, you know, there's a little cultural divide going on there. But anyway, on a lighter note, his father, amazing tabla player, and as you know, I love working with tabla, you know, working with Dalbir. Yeah. And Dalbir's guru, you know, is Sukhvinder Singh Namdhari.
Wow.
One of the most amazing tabla players in the world, up there with Ustad Zakir Hussain, you know. So
there's Pinky as well, isn't there? Pinky, I've seen him.
Pinky
before,
is the guy I'm talking about. That is.
Oh, I've met him. I've met
Sukhvinder Singh. Yeah. Sukhvinder Singh Namdhari. Yeah. Namdhari. Yeah. The Pinky, as he's lovingly known. So, but anyway, coming back to Raj, and yeah, his father is an amazing player too. And up in Leeds. And actually, Dalbir is from Leeds as well. So they're both players. I think Dalbir comes from the Benares, Haryana. So I've learned a lot about tabla and rhythm. It, you know, it's kind of a part of the way that I play, because I love the way tabla players think. So to me, it's like when it was Ravi Shankarji's, like, popularized because his connection with the Beatles and also being an amazing player, and then it's passed on to his daughters, and everybody talks about Anushka Shankar and so forth, and the other daughter as well, his name, because she has an English name, very famous, she's a very famous lady. And so both of the, you know, that whole family tree. But I actually prefer that untold story of Allah Rakaji, you know, father of Zakir Hussain, his tabla is in the British Museum. You know, that tabla that he played is in the British Museum. And, you know, he's the father of that school and society, train of thought. And the instrument, solo instrument. And I love to tell that story, me personally, as opposed to the one that the West likes to tell of the Beatles discovered, you know, Ravi Shankar and that story. Because that's the thing that, you know, it's just that perpetuated on and on. We never move on. Exactly, you know, we never explore any other stories. And I like that story about the guy, the other dude, the amazing double player, his story, and his son who became the most popular double player in the world. And Pinky's story, you know, another amazing double player. And you can see them on Durbar Festival and things like that. And just their mathematical minds. I mean, like yourself, you know, when you understand physics and electronics and so forth, and they understand mathematics, the mathematics of their playing is second to none. You know, the way they can build fractions within to whole numbers and still know where the first beat of the bar, the sum, where that falls. I used to sit there for ages talking with you know, Dalbir or Raj's dad, you know, in the, you know, they'd teach me basic time cycles, you know, like a 12 beat cycle would be a din din dakitidadina katta dakitidadina din din dakitidadina katta kitidadina din din, or you know, 11 beat cycles, din, terakita, din, na, tu, na, ka, da, de, da, din, terakita, din, na, tu. You know, it's like, and never mind din ta, which is a 16 beat cycle, or, you know, there are so many. But just when you start learning those things, your playing changes. I started to change the tuning of my guitar because of it, like this one here. Every time I play that, actually, it makes me want to play.
What I was gonna, what
born was gonna... in the Pakistan. Dun, 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 dun. I wasn't born in Pakistan, I was born in Manchester. But
do you know
that's what... the sound. But for me, you know, this instrument, it goes like this. Going to pick up my plectrum. I'll pick up a plectrum.
Cool, mate.
Plectrum. Sorry, anybody knows that Penguin advert. I love the tone, messing with the tone.
Oh, wow, yeah. That's
and it's just an acoustic guitar, but you know, but the tuning, this is an open tuning that I've used to, so that I can come up with, you know, fancy chords. Well, I mean, they're not tunings per se, because it's more like timings, I think you're talking about. But
no. A equals, traditionally, well, as the modern.
Well, you mean in frequencies? Are you talking about 440 hertz?
Yeah.
I've tried that because there's so many theories about frequencies, and that 440 is not the right frequency, standard pitch to tune to, which I think is right, actually, because if you look at players like Jimi Hendrix and a lot of the players, you know, where it kind of took off after the, you know, birth of valve amplifiers as such, and they started to explore, well, their guitars were a whole tone down. Basically, yeah. And I thought, why are they a whole tone down? Is it just because of the tension in the strings? Is it because of something else? But it was amazing to see that it just felt right. Something was drawing them to that lower frequency. So they were tuning instead of at 440, they were tuning at instead of E, they were at E flat, sometimes to D, and that was quite interesting. But for me, this tuning was the relationship between having, I mean, this is the tuning is made up, it's CCG, GCD, which is weird. I have this D at the end when I've got, but I really like that, you know, that. I think it's because I love the drones and the sympathetics of sarod and sarangi and sitar and sitar. You know, it's the kind of thing I've always loved, and having those drones within the tuning, but I can still play chords within it, you know. It's kind of... tuning is making play like that. I'm making chords up. There's no set chord there. There's no shape that I recognize. And that's what I love about open tuning, is just what it does to you. And even this aspect of, you know, I love that deeper kind of tone. And it has a kind of a quality of, almost bass player style kind of.
You know? Oh man, so I think playing slap for you is not a problem.
No, it's not. But I mean, because I'm a bass player too, as much as I'm a guitarist, so it's always that kind of.
Don't you find I've got big monster scary hands, you're like murderer hands.
No, right? No, average. Yeah, my hands are an average size. I don't think they're like scary Michael Jordan hands or anything like that.
So basically Magic jumping Johnson. From bass to lead, isn't that like going like you've been moved from your cell to a smaller cell, like this? You can't move about on the fretboard?
Yeah, I mean, you're talking technically, it's about your hand position and how you orientate your hand. I mean, when I've been teaching young kids in the early days, you know, that I kind of used to talk to them about orientating the hand to make it comfortable, so that things like stretches are just about how you position your fingers and about the percussive nature of your, I mean, forget my right hand, that kind of nature of having your left hand and being able to percussively, again, it comes back to the tabla, where I felt the percussive rhythms of the way they played was what I wanted to do, that I wanted to play percussively, to be able to make a note sound and feel the rhythm of what I'm supposed to being the fastest player in the world or something. And, you know, it's nothing like that. It's about feeling rhythm within melodies and within the playing as such, you know.
Touching emotion, isn't it?
Yeah, and then obviously I will play in different time cycles. I will kind of, you can count that, you know, it's a 5-beat kind of cycle, and it's split in a 2 and a 3, so that's like a 1 2 1 2 3.
I've had 3 questions come in. The first one is, how old were you when you learned to play the guitar? You forever learning?
7 years old.
Seven years old.
I've never had lessons. I'm self-taught. I can't read or write music. I'm completely self-taught. I just learned from records, from vinyl, from CDs, from cassettes. In the early days, vinyl and cassette. And then little bits of information from people who could play guitar. And then my brother could play, and then he would teach me some stuff. And then I went to the library, Longsight Library in Manchester, and they had a lending scheme. And I used to borrow vinyl and go home, learn an album, take it back, and take another one out. Just kind of, the first thing I learned was that kind of rhythm. You know, I heard it on a record, wanted to learn to play, but 7 years old, 8, and then I've never stopped playing, you know, to this day. I'm play all the time, write all the time. And surprisingly enough, I can't read or write music, but I wrote a symphony, a South Asian symphony, Lord to Longsight, for the Manchester Camerata Orchestra. You know? And that's the kind of thing that why I'm doing these projects, you know, when I'm working with Lancashire County Council, is because I want people to see what is possible, what you can do. And if an ugly, you know, Asian guy like me, you know, an old geezer can do what he's doing, imagine what you can do with your good looks and your youth and your talents and
You're
stuff.
Definitely, you know, not talking to me, but he's talking to you, to the listeners.
Talking to you, the listener, the public. You know?
Do you know, I think...
Ask me another question. Ask me another question.
All right. Tell us about your first experience playing in front of a live audience. That's not my question. That's been sent in.
My first experience was at school. So it was in a school band. My brother was playing guitar and he made me play bass. That was my first experience. And I had one of these Fender Precision copies. And it wasn't mine. It was a friend's bass. That was my experience. And it was the most unbelievable, ultimate experience. People looking at you, people shouting and screaming. I mean, you're at school, everybody's going to enjoy themselves regardless of what you're doing. But you're there, aren't you? Because you think, hey, all my mates are watching and all my friends and all those girls are watching me as well. And that was my first experience, being at school, playing bass in a band while other people were doing what they were doing, playing guitar. So my first experience wasn't actually... Well, actually, live, yes, I did play guitar. And I was 12, 13 years old. I was playing in pubs because my next door neighbor was a rockabilly and he knew the rockabilly band. So I'd learned all these Shadows songs. And so I just used to go to the pub because of these rockabilly bands. And the landlord would let me play because he knew I wasn't drinking at 12 years old. And I was all that kind of thing. And he knew, you know, I was a babe in the woods kind of thing. So... that was my first experience, I think. And that was like, whoa, I'm in a pub. You know, for an Asian guy, that was like, I'm in a pub with white people. It was a hell of an experience. But let me just grab another guitar. One second.
Cool. We've had another question come in, basically saying your most embarrassing moment on stage. Ooh, okay. That seems interesting. Have a think about that one.
Most embarrassing... on stage, yeah. It's funny that because it was part of the guitar collective about the Spinal Tap moments. That was actually one of the things we were going to discuss. And I could, fortunately or unfortunately, couldn't make that session. So there you go. Let's move up to the harmonica. There we go. We need a sound. Oh, I love this. I'm a bit more confident about it now, all this digital fandangled kind of technology. But those are the kind of tunes we used to play in those days. Those kind of rockabilly tunes, and I learned to play these tunes. I don't know if you know that tune.
I don't.
Anyway, I've got it all wrong now. Completely messed up. Man of Mystery.
Wow.
So it's like Shadows. I was learning Shadows songs. So I used to play in the pub. Anyway, back to that question. The pub was the first experience at about 12 years old, and playing like Shadows and Buddy Holly and Bill Haley and the Comets and that kind of... you know, those kind of things.
God, yes.
You know, they're the early days for me. That's where I used to play, you know. Elvis and all that kind of tunes. And I learned how to play those Shadows solos and But anyway,
absolutely beautiful. July last year, you dropped the key of three. Now, why was it called the key of three? Could you explain that?
It was called the key of three because it was a statement of about the musical illiterate, the unwashed, wow, of which I am a member. So the key of three, if you turn the three around, it's the key of E, and the song is in the key of E. But it makes no difference to me because I can't read or write music. So regardless of what key, as I demonstrate with that Jesse J track, that it don't matter. I'll play to anything. You know, my ears will tell me where to play. So I wanted a track that represented some form of beauty of that kind of elitist classical, you know, sound and tone, but written by an illiterate person, a musically illiterate person, so that people could relate to the fact that it's a God-given gift, you know, that anybody can write sophisticated music. You don't have to be trained. You can have it in you, imagination and so forth. So I wanted a track, an instrumental. And also it was a piece that it was a launch of my digital kind of output and career from last year, because I released it last year within that, you know, in the lockdown last year. So it was two things. It was a new era, and secondly, it was about something that represented me and other people who wanted to write sophisticated music, if they wanted to. So it was called the Key of Three, as a bit of cheek, a bit of mank cheek. Yeah, I can feel that. Monday's tune coming on again. Anyway, it was that, basically. Yeah, the Key of Three.
Wow, yeah. Love it. I think we've got a very interesting artwork for that. You've got a guitar with skulls on it as well.
Yeah, it's not in this collection here. It's in the storage stuff normally. And anyway, that's another. That guitar has got another story behind it, where it is and so forth right now. But we won't go into that.
Oh, that sounds very interesting. But all right.
Well, it is. Yes, it is and it isn't. But yeah, a friend of mine designed it, Martin, who does all the LED inlays for my. I suppose I can, if I make the effort. I can demonstrate quite easily by putting this guitar down. So this is my main, was my main guitar on the Ian Brown tours. As most people know, my see-through Aziz's green Manalishi guitar.
Beautiful.
And it has this too. You ready?
Wow.
It's powered by the two Duracells, which are under green tape. But it's been customized, all the parts on it, they're customized parts, graphite, Graftex slip kind of stuff, and PAF Pros, and the electronics have been changed. And even the headstock has new tuners, and it has a drop D tuner as well. You can drop to a D from an E straight away, or whatever you tune to. You can do a whole tone down. Coil taps to go single coil on the pickups. It has that's how I switch the lights on, basically. And there's a few other things going on with it as well. But so Martin from Sims Custom Shop, they do guitars and scratch plates and all manner of things now. But in the early days, they were doing these fiber optics and LED fittings within the, dropping them into the neck and the fretboard, and lasers as well. I've got guitars with lasers in them.
A guitar with lasers in it?
Yeah, so.
But do you mean the actual beam shoots out of the guitar?
I can't demonstrate it right now because these are switches for the lights, basically.
Yeah.
And this has got the LEDs in, but I think the batteries are flat in this, so. It's got the same thing, but these are pink LEDs.
Yeah.
And then in the headstock, I don't know if you can see that. Sorry, let me get the focus.
Yep. There's like a, what is that at the end? Oh, wow. So it doubles as a weapon to basically shoot the...
So the laser's pointing straight out. Also, they're in a box. I didn't know I'd probably need to pull them out. I've got laser rings. which sit on every single finger. The extent I go to for tacky entertainment, but 10 lasers used to sit on each finger and from a power pack on the wrist, and used to shoot out into the audience like 10 lasers.
Oh, that's amazing. That, especially when you got like, you know, the smoke in the club, that'd be shooting through. That'd be brilliant, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, never mind a club, but, you know, I was playing with, like, town halls and arenas and whatnot, and Glastonbury Festival. And when it was dark and there was dry ice and smoke, you would see these beams for, like, you know, endless. Yeah. They'd go.
I see why you did it now. It makes sense. Yeah.
I mean, I was thinking about the stage, really, about entertainment and so forth. Yeah.
So, are you looking forward to being back on stage and performing again now things are opening back up?
I'm a bit reticent about that because I don't know what's going to happen and what's going to change. And also for the haves and the have-nots and the vaccinated and the unvaccinated and the, you know, the great divide between those two camps. You know, we're a divided nation and we're a divided world. And to me, it's the haves and have-nots. If you have, then you can do this and you can go here and you can come in here. Mm. And it's just building a divide and rule thing and dividing people, absolutely dividing them. And the government standing by because they don't need to do anything. They're letting people self-police.
That's right.
They're letting businesses and companies do it. And I find it very worrying. So, like I said, I've got that survivor mentality. So I'm here on your screen and I will continue to make content for the screen because I'm loving this. I can share a lot of things personally with people who want questions about songs I wrote for Paul Weller or wrote with Ian Brown or wrote with Asia or wrote with whoever or Overload Stern or something. That's, you know, I can show those things through technology and keep building, you know, content like in this way and release music. Obviously, I very much miss live playing because I am, as you can tell by the lasers and that stuff. I'm about live playing, absolutely about live playing. But until a solution comes, apart from conforming, then, you know, we will see, you know, I will miss it dearly. I do. And I'm in a new chapter, you know. Yeah. I've thrown the TV out of the hotel room window, you know, I've done all that. I don't get drunk because I don't drink. But, you know, I've lived that rock and roll life for decades. But I'm in this area now where I'm exploring culture. I'm exploring arts, I'm exploring heritage and trying to find my place and my identity and also helping others with their identity, what they feel and maybe, you know, along the route, other people what I'm doing, it resonates with them.
Yeah.
That they can pick up, you know, information or ideas. And that's my work into, you know, I'm working at Helmshaw Mills, you know, I'm a rock and roll artist in Helmshaw Mills. And it's a beautiful area, beautiful place, as is Gawthorpe Hall, absolutely stunning. And Clitheroe Castle, you know, I'm the Pakistani man in Clitheroe Castle on the parapets and, you know, the walls surrounding, we're looking out on Clitheroe. And it's what are you doing there kind of thing. But,
your character, like you're very grounded. Like, you know, a lot of people, if they achieved half the stuff that you've achieved, they'd be, you know, I've met many people which are up their own bum, which isn't good. And you haven't even mentioned the fact that BBC introducing musicians masterclass, you featured in that. And I thought, why? So how was that?
I don't know what to say about those things because, I mean, I can remember Gary Barlow doing them. So, you know, it's like me saying that I did them. I did some masterclasses. Yes, they were from Abbey Road and from Maida Vale Studios. It went out, you know, 5 live and 6 music or whatever the channels were and interviews. Yes, they're a part of this history, this. You know, I think about it, you know, people say, oh, you should write a book, autobiography. And all I can hear is Ian Brown's words in my head, you know, autobiographies are for big heads. You know, I can remember that. Autobiographies are for big heads. And as I talk about grounded, nah, it's not cool. It's like, you know, leather pants. You know.
Oh, boy.
So, I don't know. I mean, I feel, yes, it's a very much a part of my history, playing the, you know, doing BBC introducing. But BBC for me, no disrespect, or maybe it is disrespect, but it's very tame, you know. Yeah. It's very controlled, very contrived. And for me personally, yeah, I sat there and there were some nice players, but I don't feel a connection with it really. Apart from, hey, it's an opportunity and people are bigging you up because you're on that, which I take for granted. But it's because I've got a focus and an agenda of about my kind of, I want inclusion, I want things like that, I want multiculturalisms in there, I want gender, you know, diversity. And there was, actually, to be fair. There was a fabulous guitarist from Bradford. And she was, you know, she's a brilliant player. And also, I can't remember names. It's the age, you see, the age. Yeah, I can get back on that basketball court now, aren't I?
Yeah. What I was going to say is, I like the point that you raised about this new world that we live in and where we are self-policing and this sort of like... Because what I tried to do over the past couple of months or past month or so, I tried to get Dr. Vernon Coleman on the show and also Dr. Mike Yeadon of Pfizer. And that, believe it or not, they actually got back to me, even though I'm a small fry presenter. They actually got back to me and they gave me the thumbs up, but they did decline because they're busy with their schedules. And Vernon turned around and said that he's not familiar with using Skype and what have you, but it's fine. But just to have their thumbs up and their basic support, and you know they've been saying this for a long time. Regarding what's happening in society, and you've got those haves and have nots, and I think I'm going to be part of the outcast underclass and you know, maybe stoned to death.
I hear you. Yeah. I hear you absolutely. I mean, I don't know, where do I sit in that, you know, because people are so adamant that they are right.
Exactly. You must comply.
Not just that. I mean, both sides, you know, everyone is adamant that they are right. Everyone is adamant. So we have a divide.
Yeah, we
and,
do.
And obviously the haves will, because that has the government backing, or is the government agenda maybe, will carry more weight. And it will be very difficult for those that don't. I have a feeling, you know, we don't know what's coming. We've got digital passports coming. We've got all manner of tracking. God knows what. And I've never been one for the press, excuse me.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
You know, they were never friends. You know, the press have never been friends. And for me, media has always been something that has been exploited, even in the music industry, you know. I used to get slagged off and slated from the 90s, from when I joined the Roses in I had nothing but slatings and slagging offs, and it was a completely different world from what I knew. And then as the digital world developed and online and the internet, and it grew to levels, unprecedented levels of slagging people off, and the censorships and the so forth had to catch up in a way, or, you know, but I've only ever experienced that, which made me a stronger person.
Yeah,
but I can't help but be cynical every time I switch the TV on and somebody on This Morning or whatever breakfast program or any program is like, I hear those. You remember the voices from like the 50s and the 60s and the BBC? Hello, there's the BBC. It just seems to have changed to what it is now, you know. But it's still the same thing to me, you know. And it's like the kid on the street dressed in black, you know, on his bike or on his little scooter or whatever, you know, robbing a bit of lead off a roof, or, you know, I mean, that's a kid I relate to. I relate to that, you know, very much not anti-government, but kind of anti-establishment. And and because culturally we have never stopped feeling that, you know, we're the underdog and watch your back and all this kind of thing. Yeah. And is this your country? And I can't help it, you know, because something is said every single day that makes you feel. And another reason why I'm working in these cultural spaces and sites and so forth, that I'm tired of walking in a place and feeling second class and looking at pictures and people going, oh, yes, the Raphael or the this era or that era and the pre, yeah, whatever. And I'm like looking at the picture going, well, all I can see is the black slave in it, or the little black boy with the chain around his neck, or the Asian slave helping the guy up on his, you know, on his trusty steed and dressed in red and white, and he's got a turban on and serving his master. They're the things I notice. And this is just perspective. It doesn't make that only my opinion matters or is important, but it's the fact that everybody has perspective and opinion, and these perspectives and opinions should be heard and understood, so that they're taken in consideration and that these institutions change it's a realization, isn't it? Realizing that what you're doing may be offensive to some people, may make them feel marginalized, may make them feel underdogs and so forth. You know, it crosses over into, you know, genders and all manner of factors of classisms, and it's endless, but it's a change that is needed and necessary, and it's reflected in society today and what's going on today. You know, it's going to be a struggle and a fight, but there are changes that are needed here, and there are, you know, people's opinions and so forth are a reflection of how they feel right now, and governments and the voting, like, you know, not just in the United Kingdom but across the globe, across in the West, you know, the States, and what's happening in Europe. Look at the Eurovision Song Contest.
Well, I can tell you something about that. Yeah, yeah.
Nil point. What does that tell you?
Exactly. I
was joking. But, you know, it does say something.
I used to work for the client who's on the mansions and all the rest of that, was the president of Azerbaijan, Mr. Aliyev.
Azerbaijan. You know what Azerbaijan reminds me of? I don't know why, but it just did for a moment. Cool.
Well, there's a very interesting city story about the Crystal Hall, and actually, if I say anything about this on air, I have a chance of being killed, so I'm not saying anything. But yeah.
Okay, well, don't say anything then. Let's move on. let's move on to. Hey, you! As you can tell, I'm a big Bugs Fizz fan. Yeah.
Oh, man. So, can you play that sort of, is it the Peruvian, Colombian sort of drug dealer sort of, where they hit the guitar with the thumb sort of, what's that called? It's like a funny way of playing.
A funny way of playing. I don't know what you mean. Are you talking about rhythm hand or something? I mean, yeah, I kind of do like balalaika playing, like.
Wow.
I don't know if you mean that or whether you're talking about something completely different, but everyone's playing hands. South America, they have so many rhythms. I mean, South America is the home of rhythms, you know, and diverse. So I don't really know which you're referring to, but
where they hit the body,
I don't even want to go there.
They strike the body of the guitar with the hand.
Yeah,
and it sounds like...
You're not going to hear anything on this body.
Yeah.
And you could hear on the strings. I mean, definitely, because I use the strings of...
Wow.
That kind of...
Wow. Oh, I love it. I love it.
You know. But again, that's bound to, like, the techniques of doubler or bass playing, you know, coming into...
I find that having a lot of music sent in, like Congolese guitar sort of music, and the way they play the guitars as well, it's very
amazing.
Yeah, very quick and intricate. And thinking, wow, that.
Yeah.
So, what do you find the most challenging? You know, what style is the most difficult for you?
The style of playing without playing, as Bruce Lee would say. No, sorry, he said the art of fighting without fighting. But. The art of playing without playing. And I think that art, you know, of playing is really difficult. To be able to play without actually playing it, to be able to describe it or talk about it. I don't know. I find probably most styles challenging. But jazz, to me, you know, though, I'm not a jazz player. I can't really say that I understand jazz at all, being from that illiterate school. I do like the complexities of it. I love the nuances of it. I mean, I like people like, at the moment, Julian Lage. I think he's a fantastic player, awesome player. And then there's groups and the people who draw influence from. But I do find a lot of music, just in general, challenging, as in terms of countries of origin. But I kind of grew up with, like, things that come easy to me now are things like reggae and dub and subs. I grew up with that whole kind of, in reggae bands, 10-odd years. And my friends in Manchester, in Mossad and Hume, that taught me so much. And I'm still a beginner, as far as I'm concerned. But that whole kind of aspect of rhythm. You know, I love that, what it's taught me in my rhythm hand.
Oh, wow.
I couldn't afford the pedals, you see, so I used to emulate.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Speeding up the speed of take echo.
That was next level. That is next level. That's like, yeah, but I mean,
oh, thank you. But I mean, they're the kind of things I learned, the chip and all. Just doing that, you know, as my part in the band, you know, that was the beauty of it. You know, it's just learning rhythm, understanding your place and the simplicity, less is more and so forth.
Less is more, yeah.
No,
I love it.
That kind of sound. You know, it really is something else. You know, it still makes me proud, makes me feel happy to think about what I learned within that culture and the people that taught me. Yeah.
Could you tell me about Desi guitar? Or is it Desi GUIT?
DesiGuitR, yeah, DesiGuitR. So I wanted GTR to stand. Sorry, DGR to stand out.
Yeah, yeah, brilliant.
DesiGuitR, yeah.
Arts, it's culture, just, heritage, social work.
So I mean, it came from the fact I was working on Arts Council projects and looking at identity and so forth. And I had this thing called Asian blues, which I was trying to establish. Where, let's see if we put some tone on here. Oh, so most people associate the guitar with the blues, you know, that kind of, everyone knows those sounds and tones, you know, but for me, I thought, well, what's the Asian blues? It was a story, you know, a heritage, a depression, a kind of a slavery, you know, 400 centuries of, you know, colonial rule from East India Company to the Crown. So I started to adapt. Instead of going those kind of tones, I was thinking more like, and still being able to, you know, fall into that. Things. So, for a if I switch that down a semitone. It becomes something completely different. So there's all these points of where my mindset was just thinking along a different line and identity within the play, and it came from this Asian blues idea, but it kind of solidified into the Desi guitar, because I was also looking for something online that worked in Google search and worked as an SEO, that it didn't associate, like the Asian blues associate itself with porn, so every time I searched it, Asian blues. So whereas the Desi guitar, the word Desi, you know, that homegrown kind of, you know, home cooking, whatever, and the guitar spelt in that way, it just reflecting more about where I'm at, and technology as well, and culture and so forth, the Desi guitar. Just a way of thinking. Let's turn off a second. Just a way of thinking that you don't have to just look at scale things in terms of, you know, the Western scales or the progressions that we know, that you can, even though I'm playing a rock kind of progression, I mean, I'm not even playing in the style of, I'm just showing you the notes. And then when you start getting into that world of, you know, those kind of tones or rhythm hands within.
And that's what I'm supposed to jump in now, being the Punjabi with it. Someone throw him a samosa.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah, those are the cliches of it. But you can see where I'm going with this. So there's a whole world of stuff.
What do you make?
You can start exploring, and not just that. There's the instruments. There's the emulation of instrument.
Yeah, that's what I was asking about.
If I was to play something like that, I'd be into this. Each instrument has different rhythm playing, different melody playing, different ways of playing. So
what about the transition from, you went from real Marshall amps and you've gone to the digital world. I mean, have you lost anything in, you know, coming from analog to digital, or do you still use both? Or
yeah, I mean, when you're moving air, you know, it's like you got a set of headphones on. It's not the same thing. When I got 4x12 stacked up, and as you demonstrated in that picture you used in the promotion,
yeah,
it's a completely different world. The vibe, the inspiration, the motivation, all those. I like this part because I'm exploring subtleties as well, things I couldn't hear on stage because of the racket. You know, it's more cerebral in a sense, and I love to transfer that live, but I do miss something. Yeah, obviously I miss that, but I also am learning new things, so it's compensated by the new aspects and the innovations and the explorations within this world. But I mean, nothing beats that kind of, you know, or that. Just that feeling of playing on power chords and Ziggy, run Ziggy. Yeah.
So yesterday we spoke about, like, I spoke about changing all the valves and all the rest of that. So you haven't got to worry about that stuff now. You in the digital world, you've got emulations. You can just press a button, it'll give you like a Celestion blue sort of speaker that.
Yeah.
So what I wanted to get at is okay, so could you recommend a guitar, because back in my day when I was young, the thing to have in a studio was the Pod XT, right? The Line 6 Pod XT, the studio thing, like the 19-inch rack mount thing, whatever it was. But what is today's, like anything that will do something similar?
I've already shown you that. Actually, I can share the same screen, can't I? So if I just make my screen active, there we go. This is the kind of child of the Pod XT. So this is the same company, Line 6.
Yes.
And it's HX Stomp.
And is that affordable? Well, it depends on how much you earn, really.
Well, I mean, you know, inflation and so forth. I would still say it's affordable, but it is expensive. You know, that's £300-400.
Yeah,
and they've dropped in price a lot. And it has a big brother called the Helix. And then there's alternatives, which are a lot of money. But that's kind of what the monster is that grew from the birth of the, you know, the Pod as such. And then we got into this world of profiling, where we can actually take something you have, an amplifier you love and a cabinet you love, and profile it into this computer, which is supposed to be an amp, and then store it. And then you can recall.
Rectifier?
Yeah, so I can call up a Mesaboogie rectifier, or I can call up anybody, but they're not actual models. They're actually profiles of real amps, of somebody's amp. And an amp's an individual. They're very different. You know, they're not all the same. So, and because the builds were different, so that you can store that in something like a Kemper profiler. Then there's other companies, Fractal, they do amazing stuff. And there's the latest stuff as well from Neural DSP. But I mean, you can't go wrong with something like this. It is affordable. And then you can, you know,
I've heard of Neural DSP. You can,
So I've got like a high watt kind of model there, and I'm using Harmo, refers to this guitar, the Harmony.
So it's not cold and sterile, then, is it? You know, back in the day, people say, "Oh, it's a bit cold and sterile. You've got to have a real, you know, Fox IC13 all that."
Well, you know, I mean, cold and sterile. What's that about? The put downs are kind of, there's truth in them. I'm not saying there isn't. They were cold and sterile, but you know, it's down to you as an individual how you play, how you utilize a sound, how you use that, what you're using. If you use it in a good way, you'll do it justice, and people won't be thinking about the equipment. I think people think about the equipment too much.
That's me.
And not thinking about the output of what you're doing. Yep, yeah,
that's me.
I mean, we get anal about it when really, you know, it's about the music. It's how you play, how does it make you feel? And at the moment, it makes me feel fine. I've got no problems with it at all, you know. No, I don't really complain about it, because I think about it, is it right for the way that I want to play? You know, I'm trying to play, like I showed you before, and I was trying to play kind of... You know, I just kind of, I need a sound that inspires me. Sometimes I don't want it full on and so on. I want it quite clean and brittle, just so that, you know, my hand is able to play those kind of Desi. That's my rhythm, man, you see.
You sold out Theatre One of whole Manchester, man. Come on.
Yeah, I mean, but then there was an orchestra involved, you know, the Camerata. But yeah, we told the Lahore to Longsight story, and I got to play those rhythms the way that I want to play them as well. Yeah, that's true.
Now, can you talk a little bit about your work for the NHS and Black History Month?
again, I think it was, I mean, it was part of my Arts Council project. Again, you know, music playing a part within establishments. But these were networks. I think they were equality networks. That's why I got involved. And it was Black History Month. To play some music into these networking events, which were like, you know, the NHS and the fire services and schools and you name it. So it's a network of equalities within organizations like this. And to be able to tell a little bit of a story of my, given your personal story, but showing how you play a role or a part within the culture of this country, or the mixed cultures of this country, or the confused cultures of this country, or the lack of culture, whatever. It's kind of, I just seemed to fit with it. So the invitations came, you know, like Stepping Hill and Salford and Stretford and North Manchester and Rochdale. But I told a kind of a story, and I did play some various forms of music. I did play music for Black History, but also because it was inclusive, I was playing some South Asian music into it as well. And then, but then again, just touching on recognizing artists, I was playing.
Oh. Wow.
I was playing tunes like that. I'm not saying it's just a, you know, African American music, but crossing over into other areas and territories as well.
You are what's your next challenge?
My next challenge. It's this project that I'm working on. You know, music. Museums, textile mills, and you know, country estates and estately halls and so forth, and musicians in these places, you know, that's a challenge. What am I going to do? What am I going to play? How am I going to relate to it? How I'm going to get people involved in it? How will the other people relate to what I'm doing? That's the challenge this year, you know, the sound of heritage. What does heritage sound like, you know?
Wow.
Jack boots, I don't know. door creaks, jewelry, cries and wails of young people working in mills. You know, there's so many
we were talking about this yesterday, though. We were talking about this. We were basically saying that it may not sound like what the official narrative says or makes out that it would sound like, because we were talking about John Mackey, weren't we? And we were talking about how he was sent to spy for William of Orange, and basically the list of many lords which were not actually white or pink. They were tawny, black, brown, you know what I mean? Some described as tanned, dark brown. And it's very, very, very interesting description. So, you know, the sound of heritage, what is the real sound of heritage? We need a DeLorean. We need a DeLorean. And we need to...
All I'm bothered about is getting my guitar in the shop. That's all I'm bothered about. Hey, doesn't that look cool? Hey, doesn't that look really nice?
That is a lovely guitar. Like, I bought a guitar 20 years ago and I've never learned to play it. It's just sat there and I've just never learned to play it. Can you believe it? I've always done synthesizers and production and, you know, stuff like that. I've never ever my first bass lesson was with Pete Williams of Dexy's Midnight Runners, and Come On Eileen, and I just never get. I need to make the time to play guitar. So for someone to learn, is online the way to go, to find an online tutor?
I'm the opposite. I want to learn about modular, you know, they're the kind of things I want to get into.
Really?
Yeah, modular. I mean, because I really want, I mean, I was showing you this piece before, this microcosm, and this is about granular and about micro pitch shiftings and delays and...
on a synthesizer.
I actually like that area, you know, about modular, because of the way that modular works and kind of getting down to the nitty-gritty of tone generation, oscillators, waveforms, sine waves, triangle, you know, square, wave two, you know, sawtooth. And in a sense, that's what I was doing. I was manipulating the audio with different waveforms. So I was going from triangle waveform to like different slopes as well, and noticing how it affects the tone and changes it. Yes, it was doing a hold and repeat function as well. And then I had a filter as well. I was able to filter. But it's like, I also like the idea of guitar and production and taking that out on the road or performance, like now being able to do that immediately for you. And I'm working on like sidechain compression and things like that, so that I can compress the guitar audio with a sidechain input, like a bass drum or something like that. I can take that into the iPad if I wanted to, or into probably another, through a pedal, you know, different pedals. Like the pill, I can do that through the pill. Not that pill, but a different kind of pill. And so
the red pill or the blue pill.
So you can see this world is so interesting. You know, it's really interesting. And you can see how interesting it is to me, because we've been talking for almost 2 hours.
Oh, yeah. My God. Yeah, but it's is there anything which I haven't asked you, which you want me to ask you to talk about? I know it sounds amateur to say that, but I'd rather ask and, you know, rather than you say, I should have said this to Dava. I never said this on the show, you know what I mean? What sort of a presenter is he? He's like, he's just like a dodgy Punjabi guy, you know what I mean?
Dodgy.
Dodgy.
Very dodgy. Bloody dodgy. Punjabis.
Dodgy Punjabis.
Dodgers. Always bloody dodging. Never get a hard day's work out of them. Dodgers. Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, as a Punjabi myself, yeah, that's why I can say that.
I'm dying.
Yeah. But, yeah, I understand the sentiment. Well, shall we take a commercial break here?
Sorry.
I'll play an interlude for you or something.
Yeah, sorry, man. Sorry. Oh, beautiful. Oh, my cheeks are hurting. These ones. That's sick.
Ha ha ha. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm good, man. That just made me laugh a lot. I think, you know, interviewing people like yourself is definitely one of the perks of the job, because at the end of the day, the rest of it literally is, as you know, like doing the posters, social media, technical stuff going wrong in the studio, soldering. Now, if you're going to get into synthesis, man, I strongly recommend, I can strongly recommend this unit, like I showed you yesterday, this one over here. It is the Behringer, the Model D. Mm-hmm. That is a £250 or something like that. That is a lovely bit of kit, and there's videos where they will A/B this next to a proper Moog Model D, and to be honest, it holds its own. And I thought I gotta have one of these in the studio. And if you can utilize then the external input over here, and then you can then use the ladder filter for the cutoff frequencies, what have you, and all the and I think you'll love that, because if you're getting into synthesis as well, you know, ADSR, and you know, I'm getting into it in a big way. I really love synthesizers and synthesis. What do you pick up a blue sky pedal? What do you make of those?
Blue sky.
Yeah.
Are you talking about Strymon?
Yeah, sorry, Strymon Big Sky. Yeah.
Well, there is a blue sky, I think, as well, the smaller version.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely love them. Strymon. So again, Strymon have done modular versions of the Timeline, which is their delay unit, the fancy delay unit, and they've done that into a modular version. So a lot of guitar pedal manufacturers have modular versions of their pedals. I think Earthquaker Devices has, and some of the others. But for me, I like the front end of synthesis, where you take something like this. This is a company called Montreal Assembly, and it looks so simple, but it is it's basically a fuzz box.
Oh, wow.
But it's fuzz as in square wave distortion.
Yeah.
So it's very much a synthesizer-style distortion. So, and they're a great company. This guy who makes Montreal Assembly—that's the name of the pedal. Your and Your.
Oh, wow. Wow.
MTL. So these are a Canadian company, Montreal Assembly. Yeah. And it's just a fuzz box with a tonal control, but the tone I can sweep with CV.
Yeah.
That can take CV. Yep, absolutely. So, or I can just put an expression pedal to it.
So you can filter it to the synth with the CV.
You want to hear it? Shall we plug it in?
Yeah. Hell yeah, dude.
I think we can do that. One sec.
Yeah. Thank you, Aziz. Thank you, man. Perks of the job.
Yeah, that's.
Oh yeah.
That was very old school. That, forgetting to mute.
That's all right, man. It's all good. You listen to Radiation, the number one station for the Asian invasion. And many people feel offended by the whole Asian invasion thing, don't they?
I don't know many people. Some people. Somebody's always offended. I'm offended. So, well, I have not tried this before, but
here we go.
The thing I can't do at this moment in time is obviously, and because I've got that camera on a stand, I could try holding it in one hand and playing with one hand.
Nah, just play with two hands, man. It's cool. It's about the sound, isn't it?
There we go. Yeah, it is sound, but let's have a look anyway. So the pedal there is connected into, I've got an expression pedal socket there, but at the bottom here, there's an expression pedal. Instead of a CV, I'm connecting an expression pedal into the side.
Okay.
But what that means is now that I can sweep this tone control. I can sweep that from the floor.
Oh, wow.
But I can't hold this with both hands. But that's, it doesn't matter, because I still want to get the sound across, really.
Yeah, so that's what it is. It's about the sound.
Yeah, that's what it does.
Wow. Wow. And imagine that through a stack. Oh my god.
So if I flip back to here, let me go back to here.
I see what you mean regarding filters. And
it's gated. You can see that I'm taking my hands off it. And there's no sound. But I mean, that's the nature of the square waveform, isn't it?
That's right. Yeah, of course it's it's one of those shows where, like, you realise that, like, I realise I've got no talent whatsoever.
It's going to starve the voltage, give all that. So now it ends up as it's almost like...
A dream pedal.
Look, man, no hands. Yeah, so that's what that does.
Wow.
But another company would be like this company here, which is David Rollo. And D Rollo, as his company's called there, would do something where I was talking about sidechain compression.
Yes.
Here, he's having, there's two instruments involved here. There's a left and a right, which is an input and output for each device. But each instrument interacts with the other side. Depending on how much you send to it. But it's not just compression that's caused by the other instrument or, you know, the control of one instrument over another, how it affects it. It's these functions as well, as you can read on there. They're all kind of delay orientated. There's gating effects, there's stretching, time stretching, his own term, the weave, repeating, tape effects, pitch shifting, so you can affect the signal in so many ways, and that's like an interactive way of working, micro loopers and always on loopers and granular delay and gating of, you know, there's a whole new world to explore even as a guitarist, you know.
But that would be like what, 300 quid?
It's not the price.
No, it's what
so
it
it's a reasonable
be.
Price. It's getting your hands on something like this. This is a guy in Belgium who makes the coolest stuff, and you know, they really are. They're beautiful. I mean, I love these things. I love the way it's made. I love the way he's designed it. And what it actually does is another world in itself, you know.
How's it powered? the DC jack, yeah?
So it has a DC jack, 9 volt, and it probably draws about 200 milliamps. I'm not quite sure. Maybe less, actually. Less than that. I'm just talking off the top of my head. So excuse me if I've got that wrong. Yeah, on the side, it's it does say there 9 volt, but it doesn't tell you the amp, amperage, the current
requirements, yeah.
The requirements, but it's 9 volt, definitely.
You go first. Yeah.
No, that's it. They're the kind of things that I'm interested in at the moment, you know, especially time stretch and granular and...
But what did you do about the power supply? Because I remember we spoke ages ago, I think last year or something, and we basically said about... We're talking about power supplies, and I'm talking about, oh, I've got custom linear power supplies over here, and...
I've not got to that part yet, and I wish that I had those. Bizarre. At the moment, I've only got the old traditional kind of, not traditional, but these are the been industry standard for a while, you know, toroidal transformer-based kind of isolated power supplies. That's one of the oldest ones I've got, that fuel tank by T-Rex, which is a company that doesn't exist anymore. But then the one of the most established one, even though it's got a bit of Velcro on the top, is something like Voodoo Labs. Who do a similar thing.
Well, does that thing get warm?
They get warm, but not like so hot. So, I mean, they would be like the main, you know, something like that, where a block would provide isolated power to everything. And then I can vary. They have switch. This has dip switches.
You do realize I'm geeking out
on
this.
On the back, on the back of it, it's got dip switches, but it's
beautiful. It's amazing.
You can change voltages. You know, 9 to 12, 18, whatever. You can combine to give 18 volts. You can has dip switches so that the current is doubled. It has dip switches for changing polarity so that the tip is positive as opposed to negative.
Wow.
And you get loads of cables with it. And that's an old unit. I mean, that's got to be... I've had that for about 15 years. So technology has moved on, as demonstrated. They have a version 3 Voodoo yes. Labs pedal power 3, which is super quiet, handles digital interference, everything, very quiet, as do the other companies as well, Chox.
That's the one you mentioned. I remember it's a funny name. Yeah.
And also Strymon. Strymon do their own power supply, Zoomer and so forth. There are many. And then there's the Gig Rig, which is kind of a little modular system where each individual item has its own little isolator or power that adjusts power accordingly, coming from a generator, which carries enough current.
Listeners or viewers, you're probably wondering why the hell we're babbling on about power supplies, right? And why not using just the wall wart switch mold thing that comes with it? What have you noticed using a decent power supply?
The hum goes away. The hum goes away. It's the isolation, you know, when they're sharing something, then even like sharing the mains from when you plug them into, you know, I get interference or issues of loops, you know, feedback loops. And especially in this day and age of laptops now and, you know, USB devices and so forth. And I've got loops on there on those circuits as well. But you can have buy little devices to, you know.
We're talking about ground loops, guys.
Ground loops, yeah. Ground loops. So that's what I noticed with these power supplies is that they tend to eliminate those problems I have with like analog devices, like fuzz boxes, which have transistors in them, old-fashioned silicon or germanium transistors, compared to digital devices, solid-state devices. Completely different world, and the two worlds don't meet very well very often, and you get all manner of hums and interference and noises. I'm demonstrated by that pedal, you know. I do actually like the uncontrollable, you know, that.
You need to be on Silverfinger Sing Show on BBC Radio Leeds, man.
No, it's too BBC, that, sorry.
BBC, what? yeah, you're right. Wow, I know. But I always thought he'd definitely have you on the show because that's the, like, you know, to have a Don on the show. Like, because, you know, I've been schooled today. I have been schooled to show that.
Really?
honestly, like, my life is literally with a soldering iron and a multimeter in the studio. Nice. I'm trying to build stuff with next to nothing. You know what I mean? But it's that is my life. But to actually see one person, which I think you would like reading the book, is by Preston Nichols, where he basically built the studio for Phil Spector, and I'm sure he built an amp for Hendrix. He built an amp for Hendrix. So yeah. Research Preston Nichols. Is it the Music of Time or the Lost Waves of Time or something? But it's basically he does go a bit occult in that book, you know. But where he's talking about MK Ultra mind control and how music was used to program people and stuff like that. So, but I think wow. I think you'd love that book because because it goes technical as well.
Okay.
Aziz, is there anything which I haven't asked you?
Don't ask because we're out how long we've been on?
2 hours, 4 minutes, 12 seconds, yeah. But
there you go. Well, 2 hours, 4 minutes. And it's getting hot in this attic, let me tell you.
And it's hot in the studio. Okay, could you please hit everyone with your socials? Obviously, you got the website aziz.co.uk.
Very difficult. Very difficult. Yeah, my website is aziz.co.uk, generally points at my socials. On most social media, I'm Aziz Ibrahim 56, which, you know, like Twitter and anything that requires a handle like that, Instagram, Pinterest, Aziz Ibrahim 56. Facebook is a difficult one. It's Aziz Ibrahim Music, and it's the same on YouTube, Aziz Ibrahim Music. The others, Twitch, I'm Aziz Ibrahim 56. Discord, Aziz Ibrahim 56. Yeah, I mean, I don't know where to end, not to where to start. I don't know where to end, you know. There's so many different platforms.
Maybe you could play us out with something amazing.
Something amazing?
Well, ooh. Everything's amazing in it, so.
Ooh. I don't do amazing. I'm not going to play you something amazing. I'm gonna play you something not so amazing, actually, but it's for other people. Who's there? For all of you that watch The Night Garden, or your kids watch Night Garden, and you fed up hearing that tune, I'm going to pee you off by playing it one more time. I don't know what it is about The Night Garden. That effect it has. Oh, maybe I should play something spectacular. No, I can't. It's just like, it gets a bit pompous and pretentious
to
when
do
I
it, for God's play sake, something. Man.
I don't even know what to play for you. What can I play? Stop there because I can't remember the rest of it.
It's all right. I have one more thing to ask you. Could you please say, hey, this is Aziz Ibrahim, and you're listening to Radiation, the number one station for the Asian invasion.
In that accent?
No.
Yeah, I do that in that accent. Hey, this is Aziz Ibrahim. This is Aziz Ibrahim, and you are listening to
Radiation,
the Asian station. Why did you interrupt?
No, because I wanted to guide you with it, because...
Oh, you want to guide?
Here we go. Okay. This is Aziz Ibrahim, and you're listening to Radiation, the number one station for the Asian invasion.
You know, a piece I've been learning recently... I don't know if you know the... anyway, let's not even go... start getting into... It'll never end. But anyway, yes, this is Aziz Ibrahim, and you are listening to Radiation, the Asian station.
No! no. We could be any old Asian station on some estate in Southall or whatever. No, man.
This is radiation, the one you catch radiation from.
That's very funny. And you know I hate. I suffer with electromagnetic hypersensitivity.
Yes, you do.
Yeah.
This is radiation, the station not for Asians, radies, Asians.
It'll do. That's brilliant. It's brilliant. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks for having us. No, I appreciate it.
It's
been a long session, but I've appreciated actually doing it, you know, taking part and just talking about things that, you know, talk about naturally and sharing the projects and stuff. I appreciate being able to share, you know, these up and coming projects that I've got on. And
it's important.
It's nice.
I don't want you to walk away and think, Brent, we're a genuine radio station. And we put the hard work in.
You need a theme tune, though. That's what you need.
Yeah, we do. Yeah, we do. Maybe we can get your assistance on it. You know what I mean?
Every time you hear that sound, that
it's beautiful.
You stop now. You're expecting.
Yes.
I'm good at messing things up. If you haven't realised,
nah,
all the favourite tunes of people, I absolutely destroy them. Oh, you ruined that tune.
Nah.
Yeah. You before don't. I ruin any more tunes.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to Radiation with Aziz Ibrahim and Daz.
God bless you, man.
Yes, Dav.
Yes. Rhymes with chav.
Devinder Saab.
God.
Baji.
Baji. God bless you, my brother, and thank you. Thank you for your time, wisdom, amazing knowledge, humble, grounded, and you know, I'm looking forward to checking out Flamenco.
Yeah, please do. It's only a preview at the moment, but listen to the preview on my YouTube channel, Aziz Ibrahim Music. And The Key of Three, obviously, on Spotify and blah, 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 and all those channels. And on YouTube, same channel. And this as well, because I'll be able to share this, I'm sure, once you've put it back up again.
Of course. Well, thank you. And for all of you and yourself, Ibrahim, hold it down and stay brown. And whatever colour you are, be proud of whatever it is, and just be happy. And thank you for tuning in, listening in, submitting your questions. And you know, I realise how talentless I actually am. But
Give over, man. You're very talented. Shall I play you out while you're talking? There we go. You carry on talking. You carry on talking, man. I'm going to play
all right,
you out.
Cool. Yeah, this show is going to be uploaded to the Radiation server, so it'll be played out at midnight for the next week or so. For all the international listeners, so I'll chop it into exactly 2 hours to do that between midnight and 2 a.m. And also, if you like what we're doing, check us out on Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, and all the rest of that. Should you want to send over any music to the show, send it over to newmusic@radiation.london, where we actually listen to your tunes. We don't just stick them in the bin. We listen to every song sent in. Doesn't have to be perfect. Thank you so much, man. God bless you, Aziz. Bye. Radiation, the number one station for the Asian invasion, where the presenters can't handle radiation.
You are watching radiation.
Thank you. God bless you, Aziz. Bye. Love it.